Hogwarts will play host to a legendary event. The Triwizard Tournament.
I think it'll terrify people, which is fantastic.
This tournament's wicked. It's like really dangerous.
People die in this tournament.
Well, it's a marvelous thriller.
The Goblet of Fire. Only one will go down in history. Only one wins eternal glory.
So you get lost in this totally pretend world that has a sort of fantastical reality to it.
This film is going to hit you like bang, 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 adventure to next adventure.
Soon we must all face the choice between what is right and what is easy.
What I like about the film is it's kind of Harry's life is out of his hands. It's out of, he has no control really over where it's going.
He begins the film not knowing that there is a desperate plot against his life, and he finds out a little bit at a time.
I'm not ready for this. You don't have a choice. You're the boy who lived.
I've always said that Harry's not a hero in the Superman sense of the word hero. He's a very vulnerable, fragile kind of hero who is incredibly afraid of things and of Voldemort.
The power of the maternal love of Harry's mum has sort of destroyed Voldemort, so he wants revenge on Harry.
There is something that is getting to Harry, that is trying to get to Harry, that has infiltrated Hogwarts, that Dumbledore doesn't know what it is, where it's coming from, or how to stop it.
If you can't protect me now, then who can?
I'm afraid there are no more easy answers, Harry.
Of the four films, this is the biggest and greatest adventure because we have the Triwizard Tournament.
The tournament brings together three schools.
I love when they do that.
For a series of magical contests.
It's an old tournament initiated hundreds of years ago, and it's very, very dangerous. I'm glad I'm not in it.
Three schools come together, Hogwarts, Beauxbatons, and Durmstrang. And a single student from each of the schools is asked to carry out tasks.
And they're all kind of potentially fatal tasks they have to get through in order to ultimately be the winner.
But it's all very intense stuff and lots of things that Malfoy would take a nice safe distance from.
First task is that you have to get a golden egg from a dragon, of course.
The dragon one's gonna be wicked. That's gonna be like, it's gonna be really dangerous.
The second task is an underwater task where something the contestants value are taken, put underwater. The third task is a maze.
In the maze, you'll find no dragons or creatures of the deep. Instead, you'll face something even more challenging.
Such a complicated maze that you could actually disappear in there and never come out again.
Wicked.
I think it's great for people to realise that this wizarding world is a whole world.
Part of this film is actually about bringing people together, because what lies ahead are dark things.
And now the champion selection. If chosen, there's no turning back.
Everyone puts their name in the Goblet of Fire, and the Goblet of Fire chooses the three students, and then there's a fourth name comes out as well.
Harry Potter!
There's a huge uproar because he instantly knows that everyone suspects him of some kind of foul play in putting his name in, and because he knows he didn't put anyone's name in. Someone else must have.
How did you do it?
I didn't put my name in that cup. I don't want eternal glory.
It's particularly hard for him to be put through these terribly dangerous tasks when he doesn't actually want to be there. He wants to be back watching with everyone else.
Don't let Potter compete.
The Goblet of Fire constitutes a binding magical contract.
Mr. Potter has no choice.
There's some fantastic new actors and actresses who are also sort of around our age as well.
It's very nice to meet new people and bring them all to the family.
It's been important for us to find actors who really at their heart capture the essence of the characters they're playing.
Victor Crumb!
Yeah! Victor Crumb is picked as the champion of his school, which is the Doomstrom School, which comes from Bulgaria.
Who's that?
Yeah!
This is the best seeker in the world!
Crumb!
He is the hero worldwide. He's worshipped by other players.
He's the real kind of man's man, really tough, strong, brave, and fantastic at sports.
We are here to see me dive in the deep waters of the ocean. I'm initially from Bulgaria, but I've been living in England. And for the film, Victor Crumb isn't really good at English. So I do go back to a rough, tough Bulgarian accent.
You have no business here. This tent is for champions.
When I'm here, I feel as if I'm really in Hogwarts. I feel as if this world is real. I've really been made feel part of the big family.
The champion for Beauxbatons is Fleur Delacour.
Fleur Delacour is a French wizard. She is what English think a French girl would be.
Bloody hell.
When the girls enter, just every man in the Great Hall was kind of going, and Clemence is beautiful, and the character Fleur is completely beautiful.
I was a huge fan of the books. Just being thrown in a world that doesn't exist and that works beautifully, it's a very new experience for me.
What she delivered in the end was this tremendous poise, which may not be French to the French, but it is French to the English.
The Hogwarts champion, Cedric Diggory!
Cedric is sort of all-round nice guy. He plays fair and he sticks to the rules like he should.
He is the archetypal superhero who does get the girl, which is, just as a contrast to Harry, I think works fantastically.
As per usual.
Thanks.
And he sort of, in a way, takes Harry under his wing.
Rob, who is this gorgeous golden boy, so good-looking and so English public school, and you look at him and you just think, yep, that's it.
It's Mad-Eye Moody, dark wizard catcher.
So he's there specifically to look after Harry, but also I think he feels the need that he's going to grow these kids up pretty quickly.
Mad-Eye Moody, wow.
I'm here because Dumbledore asked me. End of story. Goodbye, the end. Any questions?
Moody just as a whole is just bursting with character, and he has this unbelievable moving eye, which is just...
You need to find another place to put your chewing gum besides the underside of your desk, Mr. Finnegan!
Oh, no way. The old codger can see at the back of his head.
I'm here across classrooms!
He's something else, I think Mad-Eye Moody is. You know, he's a very intimidating person.
Which curse shall we see first? Weasley!
Yes?
Stand!
Ron really likes him. Quite strict, but he's just crazy and completely mental.
He's a mixture of somebody who knows that there are dark things happening all the time, but has gone over the edge a little bit. Actually, when it comes down to it, he's a gunslinger with a wand.
Oh, no, you don't, Sonny!
He's such a student!
I'm Rita Skeeter.
What makes a champion tick?
Should we start with the youngest?
Lovely.
She's absolutely horrible. She's such a piece of work. No one else could play her apart from Miranda.
Everyone loves the rebel, Harry.
Well, I call her the caring, sharing face of investigative journalism.
Your attitude shows at best a pathological need for attention, and worst, a psychotic death wish.
She'll do whatever it takes to get a story which she's already pre-written in her head.
The Dark Lord shall rise again.
Above everything else, there is the appearance of the true villain. There's Ralph Fiennes doing the creature of ultimate evil, for which he is immensely well suited.
My one.
One of the things that made me want to do the role was Mike Newell showing me these drawings, artwork, about the look, the suggested looks of Voldemort. I wanted him to be really humanly evil, not an idea of evil.
He's back! Voldemort's back!
They're more than enemies. Enemies doesn't quite do it justice. At the same time as hating him with every fibre of his being, Harry is also absolutely terrified of him.
Expelliarmus! Harry!
The event is the Triwizard Tournament.
John, thank you very much.
What I like about the way Mike has directed it is that you never quite get away from the dark elements of the film. It's always there in the background, even if it's not the focus of the scene in any way.
You're reaching and loving it. Off you go.
One of the things that Mike has brought to it is a real sense of British boarding school. Even though there is a really dark part to it, it still has this fantastic sense of humour.
Hello, Harry. Long time no see.
Just because I laugh doesn't mean you have to stop. Could you start again?
If you do something funny, he'll laugh. Even though it'll ruin a take, he'll still laugh just to make sure you know it's funny. And I think that relaxes you so much.
He is amongst the foremost directors of actors. And, you know, it's important for us to keep the kids challenged, to maintain the high standards that have been set.
Zap, you're brought back.
He speaks to every possible person in the scene to make sure everyone knows exactly what they're doing.
Weasley!
Yes!
He's really into sort of like us putting our own sort of input into the characters.
To have cast children so brilliantly who have gone through four films now from a very young age to adolescence and still to find them interesting and involving and disciplined is extraordinary.
Do you think we'll ever just have a quiet year at Hogwarts?
No.
No, I didn't think so.
In this film, Harry, Ron and Hermione have their first real exposure to the opposite sex.
Ron's changed a bit, like, just he's a bit more mature now. He's got a bit more comfortable around girls and that, because there's the Yule Ball. And...
On Christmas Eve night, we and our guests gather in the Great Hall for a night of well-mannered frivolity.
When I read the script, I knew that a lot of the scenes with Rupert and Dan and this whole issue of finding a partner for the ball would be really funny.
Why do they have to travel in packs?
Basically, we find it really hard to find a date, and it's sort of getting a bit embarrassing because everyone else is getting dates, even like Neville.
What I like about Harry as well is he's pathetic at the whole romance thing. He's rubbish.
Shush.
And he falls completely in love with Cho Chang. It's not even a crush. He loves her.
Harry.
Cho.
She's really pretty, and the Harry Potter has a crush on her, so it's like, I feel like the luckiest girl in the world.
Cho?
Yes?
I just wondered if maybe you want to go to the ball with me.
Sorry, I didn't catch that.
I was just wondering if maybe you wanted to go to the ball with me.
He's a character for anyone out there who's ever been awkward with a girl in this film, which is probably every male anywhere in the world.
Wait, Hermione? You're a girl.
We're well spotted.
Can we run away? Shut up.
The really awkward teenage stage where you're just kind of coming to that age where girls and boys are interested in each other and neither of the sexes quite know how to be. And it's very funny.
He just asked Fleur de la Cour to the ball. Actually, he sort of screamed at her. It was a bit frightening.
What did he do then?
What else? I ran for it. It's sort of more fun when you're like, sort of acting it, but in real life, it's pretty scary.
What are those? No, those!
My dress robes.
Well, they're all right. No lace, no dodgy little collar.
Well, I expect yours are more traditional.
Traditional? They're ancient.
These kind of sharp little insights about what it's like to be 15 were really marvellous.
She kind of has a boyfriend in this one. It's nice because she's never had anybody look at her in that way before.
Crumb takes Hermione out for the Yule Ball and she's really transformed into a princess.
I was so nervous about the whole thing, because it's meant to be such a big moment, and it's going to be an anticipated moment.
That's when Ron and Harry don't believe their eyes.
She looks beautiful.
Yeah, she does.
For Ron and Harry, it's a bit of a shock, really. Especially for Ron, who, you know, he's only just realised that she's a girl.
Is that Hermione Granger with Victor Crumb?
No. Absolutely not. The beginning films, you sort of sense like a relationship between them two.
Victor's gone to get drinks. Would you care to join us?
No, we would not care to join you and Victor. And I guess he's sort of jealous. You're fraternising with the enemy.
The enemy? Place your right hand on my waist.
Where? We had to waltz around in front of everyone. It was a bit embarrassing, but it was quite funny, so...
Poor Ron. I mean, you know, we're both... I mean, I've got two left feet too, so we both look pretty silly.
No, move the leg. And this way. No, you will have to lead eventually. Understood?
Wonderful Wayne, the choreographer, and his lovely assistants. They teach these kids to dance, some of whom could and some of whom, by God, could not.
Bit nervous, but should be all right.
One of our regulars, young Devon here, can cut the mustard in the dancing stakes. Watch out for it.
Man, I've been doing my steps, I've been working my feet. You've seen my feet work.
You trust me, don't you?
Everyone else had about 3 weeks. And I only had about 4 days to learn, so I'm quite proud of what I managed to do. It was very hard, and I got to about halfway through, and then I would kind of just lose it completely.
No practice, just going straight into it and going mad.
Oh, look at that, look at that. Lucky man, lucky man.
I was really struggling, so Mike walked onto the dance floor and gave me a spin.
Yeah!
I adored them. They're good news, each of them, and I'm very proud of them.
The design is just astonishing. I walk out of these sets and I've never been on some of these sets before, and it's overwhelming.
There had to be an enormous change that you would look at the inside of the Great Hall, and yet you've never seen the place like that before.
The description in the novel is that it's a kind of ice palace, really. There are icicles hanging from the magic ceiling. So we've taken that maybe a step further and said, OK, well, the magic ceiling is actually made of ice. Every inch of stonework will be covered in this highly reflective silver. The window mullions, the fireplace, the gargoyles, the gold doors will all be this mirror silvered finish.
When I went in, I was absolutely gobsmacked. The attention to detail and just the whole thing was beautiful, really beautiful.
With the underwater sequence, we faced one of our greatest challenges. We had to build a tank.
This was a stage. They took 500 loads of dirt out of it to create this 60 by 60, 20 foot hole. It's probably one of the biggest tanks in the world.
What we did then is create the world and create the characters that inhabit that world.
We built this rather big, elaborate trophy room. The deep, deep, deep cavernous trial chamber in the middle of the Ministry of Magic. Yeah, campground outside, 350 tents, and the Weasley tent is a magical tent. Seems fairly ordinary on the outside, but as soon as you open the doors, you know, it's 20 times bigger than it can possibly be.
Ron, get out of the kitchen, we're all hungry.
Yeah, get out of the kitchen, Ron.
Feet off the table.
Feet off the table.
I love magic.
He's one of the great film designer Stuart. He created this extraordinary grave based loosely on Highgate Cemetery, with the idea of gravestones crowding up against each other.
Where Harry confronts the dragon, the starkest, rawest, most interesting thing we could do with that would be to set it in this bare, rocky pit. The maze, we tried to make it taller than you've ever seen and bigger than you've ever seen. So you're in channels which are just 5 feet wide, but 25, sometimes 40 feet high.
A lot of things about this film are simply people allowing themselves to have fun by going to the very end of what they know they can do.
The stunts, I don't think it would have been nearly as good if people were sitting there going, oh, well, that's someone else doing that.
3, 2, 1, freezer out.
In the underwater sequence, Dan is actually swimming in a big tank underwater, and so are the other artists as well. We've got a speaking system. We can speak to him, he can hear quite well, or very well, actually, and he just signals if he's OK or just to wait a minute.
Head up, Dan, head up. Look at camera.
And the physical exertion of this, of acting underwater, his eyes open, performing while he was holding his breath, is a remarkable achievement.
I really enjoyed tank diving. It was hard work and it was very physical, but it was really rewarding.
Go!
I had 2 weeks of training to learn how to scuba dive and basically to learn how not to panic underwater. And honestly, after a week, it was just so much fun.
Swim higher, Robert, swim up to Bruce. You go, Bruce, looking at Harry.
Okay,
Harry, very good.
The underwater stuff was really, really exciting. I've never done anything like that before.
We've done this sort of wire thing where we've sort of dropped out of the sky into the ground at the World Cup.
The maze was really, really exciting because there were real explosions going off and the whole maze was hydraulic. You're running around actually fearing for your life in reality.
I think it's brilliant that we actually have the chance to do it ourselves. Nothing can beat how it looks.
I am the last of the action heroes. Someone's coming closer. I can feel it.
There are tremendous, exciting things in this film for all ages.
Abracadabra. The killing curse. Only one person is known to have survived it, and he's sitting in this room.
It's going to be a lot of action. It's going to be really good.
Get out! It's the Death Eater!
Get back to the portkey, everybody, and stick together!
Oh, no!
It's a fairy tale world, but it's much more scary.
The devils are inside the walls.
In this film, there will never be a dull moment.
Is it Voldemort?
Harry, I'm scared for you.
It's the ultimate thriller.
You should be anxious at knowing what lies ahead. And again, we all are.
Everything is going to change now, isn't it?